It is said that their glowing lights lead the way to the afterlife beyond for those fallen in defense of the Attic of Horns, the giant firefly. Spirit guide and friend to the lost souls that wander the infinite domain. There can be no better sign of luck than seeing one of these tantalizingly beautiful beasts. Though, one can't help but wonder which, if any, in a given swarm, will lead their soul to the endless night.
Well, hello, you bearded bastards, and welcome back once again to Thestar Saxul, Crimsontrumpets. Right now, the dwarves, as always, are very hard at work because the autumn caravans are about to arrive. This is going to be our first chance to do any trading, and we have to see if we can try to get some armor from them. Remember, we've done a bunch of mining already, and we found nothing but silver, gold, and nickel, which is very unfortunate. I mean, we can make some... We can make weapons out of silver. It just doesn't hold a good blade. So yeah, blunt weapons. We've been going with maces, and so we've been pumping those out left and right. But you know, we are feeling pretty good about this upcoming trade. We've just sighted a good omen. Flying around over here by these trees, we see a giant firefly. There's actually quite a few of them. Just a big bug when you get down to it, but it's also a sign of very good luck as well. For our people anyways. Now, yes, as I was saying, we are preparing to do some trading right now. And the only thing we've really been producing are maces, silver maces, which are going to be a great trade item. So like, we just made our first military squad, the Silver Clubs, but I think we're going to disband it when the merchants arrive, just so we can trade their maces. It'll be fine though, because we could just get more afterwards. Plenty of silver here. Hey, and here we go. Speak of the devils, the merchants have just arrived. Hoping they brought some good stuff, though we don't have that much to trade. Gonna keep trying to pump out those silver maces in the meantime. Hopefully we can make a few more. Guess we'll see. Yeah, okay. The merchants are getting their items all set in the trade depot here. We'll just give them a second to get situated. Oh, hold up there for a second. Okay. Pretty short visit, I guess. Not even too sure what happened. But yeah, looks like the merchants are leaving. They just turned around with their wagons and left. That's pretty frustrating. Damn it. Thinking maybe the layout of our depot wasn't... I'm not sure, not spacious enough, maybe? Surly bastards, those merchants. Well, it's gonna be fine, I'm thinking. Didn't need them. I'm sure we can manage just fine. We're just gonna have to really do some more digging to find some more metal. And so with that in mind, we're gonna start digging around up here. This is where we first found silver. And it looks like there's a bunch still left up here. But remember, we should have at least one other type of metal left somewhere in this area, if our surveying is to be believed anyways. And we really like iron. That would be excellent, because we want steel. We want steel stuff. But we'll see what happens. All I know is that this area up here is right underneath that light aquifer, and so our silver mine is going to be pretty damp. And so before anything, we have to carve out a drain, just to be safe. Oh, hold up. Okay, I guess those merchants were right to leave. I believe one of their wagons was destroyed in this tunnel here. I can see how that would be upsetting, yes. Yeah, there's just junk all over the floor. I think all the water that's coming down through this tunnel really, screwed things up. Yeah, we're going to have to figure out a way to deal with this water. But, in the meantime, got some free stuff. That's good. Gonna have a look real quick. Okay. Got some anvils, another dog. Oh yeah, got a few things here. Not bad. Oh, some food. Rotten cheese, that's what all this stink is. Very stinky tunnel here. Yeah, not too bad. Got some decent stuff. Cool. Oh, and that might be a problem. Right there. Looks like there's... I'm not too sure how this would happen, but there are a couple of horses embedded in this muddy wall right here. You know what? I think... Okay, makes sense now.
There's too much water! Going! Push through! Keep going!
The water rushing down caused these horses to panic, and they kind of they must have thrashed around a bit and got jammed into this wall. And the merchants were just like, to hell with it, leave the horses. Couldn't blame them. That's a mess right there. Like, I certainly don't want to have to deal with this. I couldn't blame the merchants for not wanting to deal with it either. Okay, we gotta get those horses out of that wall. But before we do that, looks like we have a problem up here on the surface. A giant tick has wandered into the area. That's going to be a problem right there. I don't think they're the toughest creatures, but they interrupt working dwarves, which is a problem. And, like, we don't really have the hands to go dealing with this right now. I had already disbanded the silver clubs. So, you know what? I think we're going to have to come up with a compromise here, at least until we can get some more dwarves. And so what we're going to do instead of having a full squad is, for now anyways, have one dwarf who's kind of like, we'll say, the Crimson Champion. We got a few pieces of armor off that caravan, so we're going to gear them up. And I think they'll be able to handle some of the bigger creatures that pop up, especially after they get some more training. And of course, for our first Fortress Champion, we're going to have Dastot, the Fort Waker. A pretty sturdy dwarf. I'm sure she won't mind getting her hands a bit dirty. Luckily, we're able to get a copper helm and some nice steel low boots off that caravan. That paired with a silver mace and a wooden shield we just made, she's not looking too bad at all.
One of the most notable cultural aspects of the Attic of Horns is their often finely ornamented helmets. These beautiful pieces are used to signify everything from one's profession, to status, to personal design preferences, and they can come in a variety of materials. In fact, this dwarven nation's name, the Attic of Horns, is a rough translation relating to donning horns on one's head. The headwear of these dwarves is one of their people's greatest treasures.
That paired with a silver mace and a wooden shield we just made, she's not looking too bad at all. Right now she's down in the meeting hall telling a story. Let's have a listen, shall we? She's telling the story of how in the late summer of 243, she became militia commander of the Crimsontrumpets. A bit of a rallying cry to our other dwarves, ensuring victory and perseverance. Wonderful. Looking back up to the surface, that tick is still roaming about, and Dastot has wrapped up her story and is on her way. Here's hoping she can handle this thing. It's a little nerve-wracking. I mean, a giant tick is bigger than a dwarf, by a significant margin. That being said, I don't really think it has many ways to defend itself, other than by the obvious sucking of blood. We'll just have to hope for the best. Okay, here she comes. Ready for battle. Good luck, Fort Waker. Charging in. Battle commences. The tick has begun to panic and is trying to escape. The coward, get back here. Oh, it's quicker than I thought it would be. She is swinging and missing right now, trying to stun the creature, I believe. Just swinging away with her mace. Just gotta hope for that lucky hit. Oh, just got a notification that some migrants arrived. Gonna have to wait a second, though. Come on, Dastot. Oh, she hit the thing. Some ichor's coming out of it. And I think it's beginning to slow down. She's got it. Just a matter of time now. Oh, there you go. Killed the tick. Little problem whatsoever. Okay, gonna make a note of that. Giant adders can be pretty dangerous. Giant ticks? Not so much of a problem. Yeah, that'll be a good boost in confidence, I'm thinking. Good for you, Dastot. Now, our Fort Waker is pretty confident with most things she does, but she's also well known to be fairly clumsy and extremely sloppy, which isn't a great look for a Fort Waker. You gotta be on top of your stuff in this position. Also, on top of that, she is a bit shorter than most dwarves, which that might make her feel needlessly inferior. So I can imagine her trying to prove herself to the others in any way she can. It'll be good to see her come into her own a bit more. Anyways, back to Crimsontrumpets. We can have a look here that migrant wave brought some more dwarves. Went from 13 to 18, 5 more, not bad. And strangely, 2 of those 5 were legendary blood tapers, doctors. And we got 2 in that last wave as well. Isn't that strange? Well, it might come in handy at some point, but for now I think we're going to put them on other duties. Got plenty to do. And I would like to do a little update on our mining operations. Remember, we're still trying to get very deep in the earth. But before we get to that, we got to talk to some of the dwarves. We're always getting suggestions on how to improve things around here on Crimsontrumpets. Remember, we're going to try to make a fighting arena that we're going to funnel invaders through. That's going to be a Crimsontrumpet mainstay when we get there. But somebody had the idea that we can take this arena and make it sort of segmented and have each section with like a different challenge in there or something like that. That's a very cool idea. Not too sure how we'd implement it, but we'll take it on board for now. It's an interesting suggestion for sure. We also had an urgent call to improve our equipment, which we're trying desperately. The people want us to keep mining and trading for better metals and make sure our smiths are only making top grade equipment for our dwarves, which we are trying to do. We just have to remain patient, dwarves. This location isn't exactly wowing us so far, unfortunately. One of the most compelling ideas I saw is regarding King Ustra. Some dwarves think that we should adorn our walls with his likeness, which I heartily agree with. Not only would it please and pay respect to our king, but it would also insult and shock invading goblins who come to try to destroy us. Yeah, I think that'd be a very good idea. We'll get to that right away. And actually, here's another idea I thought would be shockingly amazing. We should have a fitness area, just so we can keep our dwarves in shape. We can accomplish this by making a small room over here and filling it with screw pumps. that we can have manned. Now, they're not going to be connected up to water, but dwarves can actually come and work on them, and it will help to bulk them up. Very excited to see how that goes. We'll have to pick some dwarves to go in and keep a good eye on them. Now then, done speaking with the dwarves, so let's get an overview of this tunnel here. As you can see, it is quite long. It stretches down past our living area and continues down to the south, cutting through a couple sections of stone. And we've had to build some more bridges, too. But it leads down here, just to this garnierite cluster, and it continues downwards, down through the stone to just about here. And we're just going to continue down. It's a work in progress. Right now, though, we're trying to clean up this hallway a little bit. As you can see, right up here, there's actually, well, it's a bunch of tower cap trees that have grown up through this crack, and we just had to mine around it. But we can't really do anything with it right now, so it's just totally blocking up the hall. And so if we look down, you can see it continues through this crack, and it's actually sprouting out of this water down here. So it's not going to be as easy as just cutting down the mushrooms. But as you can see, we have come up with a little bit of a plan. Might be very dangerous, and I'm not too sure if we're quite ready to implement it yet, but I guess we'll try it. So, all right, we're going to cut away these three trees. Okay, and as soon as we cut away one of these end ones, all the water from the caves is going to come try to rush into this room. But, I mean, if it doesn't flow in fast enough, we'll have some time to maneuver around. As long as we get those trees cut down, we're fine. We're cutting out those middle walls now, and there's only a little bit of water that's stuck in between those trees. So, this should be fine right here. Not going to get too much water in quite yet. We'll get that one middle tree cut down before the others. And actually, we're going to come underground and carve out a bigger area as well, just for safety's sake. Make sure there's a lot of area for that water to pour down into. Don't want to be too stupid here. Also, I should note that while this is happening, I'm trying to keep eyes on this troll down here, approaching the stairway that leads up to the tunnel in our living quarters, getting way too close for comfort.
Distant cousins of the goblins, a typical troll stands taller than a human, is far more well-muscled, and bears a coat of thick fur over its frame. Additionally, trolls also sport dual pairs of both tusks and horns, giving them a fierce appearance indeed. Though, despite these facts, trolls are some of the most harmless creatures to come from the caverns below our feet.
Way too close for comfort, just kind of milling around that stairway there. Oh yeah, the rat bastard thinks it's being a sneak, climbing right up the front of the tunnel, not using the stairs. Yeah, I don't know what the plan is here, guy, but the Fort Waker is not gonna have any of this. Oh yeah, look at that bastard, coming right on up. All right, this is a dangerous place right here, but we have to take care of this. The Fort Waker is on her way as we speak. No doubt the thing is eyeing our workshops. Oh, maybe just a bit curious. Came around that corner, took a peek at our meeting hall, and now is running away, being chased by Dastot. Oh yeah, the thing's panicking, running down the tunnel. Getting beaten good, too. Yeah, get him, Dastot. Gotta be careful here, you don't want to fall off. Oh yeah, there she goes. Beating the hell out of this bastard. Get him. Oh, that's a good fight right there. She's gonna get a lot of good training just from killing monsters that come into our home. Well, she's got it down on the ground now. Really letting it have it. It's gonna probably gonna bleed out before she can actually land a killing blow, I'd imagine. Oh, hell. Yeah, you gotta bulk up a bit there, Dastot. She's clubbing it in the head repeatedly, but yeah, she can't seem to do the trick. Keep working at it. Wow, really? Holy hell, okay. Looks like somebody passing by is trying to help. That's good. But like, oh damn it. Dastot is now overexerted. But we have some others incoming now. I've conscripted a bunch more dwarves to the army. Come on, guys, get in here. Finish this thing off, will ya? It's just a troll. Oh my goodness. Right now we got 4 dwarves beating it. 5 now. 5 dwarves. 6. Here comes 7. Okay. Finally we killed it. Wow, okay. We have to do better than that, dwarves. Very slow work. Yeah, we'll get better though. We'll get better. Just gonna take some time.
One notable difference from their goblin cousins is their brightly colored blue blood. It is unclear as to why their blood is of this hue, as it's a trait only rarely seen in the natural world, disregarding that of various shelled creatures, to which trolls are most certainly unrelated. Scholars tend to agree that whatever pigment it is that gives goblins their greenish skin hue was once found in the blood of their trollish ancestors, despite goblins of today having blood as red as a dwarf's.
And as for Dastot, the Fort Waker, she's actually in our fitness room right now, trying out one of these screw pumps. Yeah, eager to see what this does. She obviously has to bulk up a little bit more. Very curious to see if there's going to be actual progress from this. Honestly, I'm not even sure if it'll work, but I guess we'll see. Right at the moment, as for her physical attributes, It says she's slow to tire and that she's tough, but also that she's clumsy and quite susceptible to disease. I believe if she gets physically stronger, something will pop up in here to let us know. I guess we'll see. Keep at it, Dastot. And you know what? While we're at it, I think we should give her a nickname. Probably should have did it a while back, but better late than never. I think we're going to call her Adder, just because she was able to successfully lead our fortress against that first threat we took on, the giant Adder, which was actually a pretty tough adversary. Yeah, it's a nickname well earned. I think it suits her. Anyways, looking in this hallway here, you can see that middle tree is cut down now, and there's still a tower cap and a fungi wood still left in this crack. So if we move down a bit, here's this dump chamber, and you can see these grates we have in place. That'll funnel water down to this chamber right here. It's a double layered chamber, so that when we cut down these trees, the water will flow in through these grates, and we'll have as much time as that chamber allows to chop down the other tree and get the hell out of there. Let's get to it. I think right at the moment, all we have is one log taker. So I'm hoping they can cut down the one and then get straight over to that second one. It would be smarter if we had two of them, but eh, what could I say? Feeling confident. Okay, here they come. One tree is down. Easy. And the second tree. Okay, yeah, I mean, that was perfect. No problem at all. And now if we have a look back up here at this tunnel, you can see it's all cleared away. No problem. We can just fill in the gaps with some nice stone blocks. All right, let's clean up this tunnel, dwarves.
Seen by most as fastidious perfectionists, the dwarves are well known for their precise attention to detail and unique perspective of the stone. But in reality, dwarves of every culture tend to be rather stale when it comes to fortress planning. Clusters of bedrooms and long halls branching away from a central shaft is the norm. This is the only way to build a true dwarven home, according to their ancient traditions. To break away from this belief and carve a home of grand design is a foolhardy task, and is sure to anger both the gods and the ancestors.
But yeah, with that, I suppose we can continue on our way down. That's very exciting. Remember, we're still trying to find a grand location for our home, and we can't rest until we're far, far down there. We have some pretty big plans. We'd really like Crimsontrumpets to be a fortress unlike the world has ever seen. Just really hoping we come across some useful metal down here, though. Ah, well, here's something. Actually, we just discovered some tetrahedrite. It's an ore of silver and copper. And you can make copper armor, which is pretty exciting. I mean, again, it's better than nothing. Additionally, where you find some tetrahedrite, there's sure to be a whole bunch more. So, like, if we're gonna make siege weaponry, remember we suggested that? It would be nice to have a bunch of copper ballista bolts so we can fire at the enemy. It'll be a nice expendable source of metal. Or possibly our only source. Time will tell. Actually, you know what? Like, all this digging is fun, and we do have to find a place for a home, but we can't lose sight of the fact that this fortress here is populated by a bunch of fearsome dwarves who want to protect their homes through dwarven might. That's kind of a big point here. And if we do not have enough dwarves when we are attacked, we are going to be totally screwed. So that being the case, we're going to change things up a bit. The silver for weapons is absolutely fine, but we need armor in a big way. And so what we're going to start doing is digging out some of this tetrahedrite here. We have to get armor. We're being very stupid, actually. We have a necromancer's tower, like, right next door. It's startling how panicked I am right now. Like, I just realized how stupid we're being. Like, it would be nice if we had a source of magma so we could smelt and forge things really easily without the use of charcoal. And we'll get there. But, yeah, it's taken too long now. We have to do this. Right now. At the moment, we have 18 dwarves, and I'd like to get 10 of them into a devoted military. We gotta get them training. Right now it's the 15th of Opal, 243, midwinter, and so we're approaching the end of our first year. I'm sure that by now some people out there have noticed our project here with this fortress. Very dangerous. Yeah, not to mention forgotten beasts. Man, those things could pop up at any second. Yeah, we're being dumb. And so yeah, that's our next order of business, and it's going to be our main focus from this point forward. This squad right here. 10 dwarves, we have our starting 7, including Adder, and 3 of the Blood Tapers as well. Figure we might as well, I got 4 of them. Yeah, that should do the trick. And also, we're making some armor stands and weapon racks to go in a new barracks right over here, which is branching off what we're going to be calling the King's Tunnel, due to all these carvings we have in the wall now. Most of King Ustra's life events are now engraved on this one surface right here. Everything from overthrowing various governments, which he's done several times in his life, to buying a house, which is another thing he's done. We'll go into more detail about that later on, though. For now, though, we have to get to work strengthening our tiny military. Crimsontrumpets must be strong. And now, my dear bastards, we move on to talking about some behind-the-scenes things. And we do have quite a few things to talk about, too. First off, okay, the art design for this series so far. You may have picked up on it, but I'm going with a kind of a, like a vintage metal fantasy sort of a style. Thought that'd be pretty neat. I'm liking how it's turning out so far, trying to challenge myself a bit, and I'd say it's turning out pretty well. The whole helmet thing there, it works on quite a few levels, I'd say. It wasn't something I'd consciously planned. I just started drawing dwarves, and I kind of liked the look of it, so I just kept going with it. But then I realized that whole attic of horns thing, you know, attic, something that's up above, horns, like on the helmet, that works, we can write that in. And what the hell's a chance that King Ustra is gonna have the last name Attic Helped? That's pretty amazing. Gotta love when stuff like that comes together. As I had said last episode, I really like to get into these worlds and roleplay like a single player Dungeons and Dragons, say. So it makes you think about that sort of stuff. Like, why is the world like how it is? For example, if I was to go out in adventure mode right now to a dwarven fortress, all of the fortresses in this particular world, every dwarf fortress world, all look exactly the same. Not exactly, but like very, very similar. They're all a central shaft that goes down with a bunch of little like clusters of rooms coming off of them, bedrooms and halls, that sort of stuff. But like this fortress here, any player fortress, I should say, is going to look much, much different than a typical dwarf fortress found in the world of Dwarf Fortress. And why would that be? You know, maybe it's that in this particular world, it's based on some sort of a weird dwarven tradition. Of course, I suppose it could be different for other worlds too. Maybe it's some sort of a religious thing. Maybe it's a matter of practicality, typically. I don't know. Just things I like to think about. Also, I'd like to address the sudden change at the end of this episode, the realization, I should say, that we should be focusing a lot harder on our military. This morning, I woke up and I actually had a dream last night where we got attacked in this fortress here. And like, it's like I realized how screwed we would be if we were attacked like right now. And like the Necromancer's Tower is right there. The goblins don't like us, so they might show up at some point. Guys, I've gone a long time without actually having to face any sieges in Dwarf Fortress, and it's kind of ridiculous. Holy hell. Really, when you get down to it, that's what I'm hoping for this fortress right here. Because it's not something I've been able to enjoy since like, what the hell was it? Like early 2018 when I was finishing up the Monster Killer series. I want to fight off a big ass siege without having to worry about my dwarves getting all stressed out and stuff. And I guess I'm assuming it's still possible to fight off goblins at that level right there. Like, I mean, back in the day, it was pretty straightforward to fight off hundreds of goblins with just a fairly small army, maybe like, say, 40 dwarves. Just gotta get them to have that skill and stuff. But yeah, I'm out of practice. Really hoping that this fortress becomes a thing and just doesn't end up in a big fart noise. But I guess we'll see. As I said in the episode, if we get attacked by a necromancer right now and are expected to repel the relatively few zombies that they send at us, then yeah, we're screwed. We couldn't do it. We could have a forgotten beast with web show up right now. Our first forgotten beast could be a web shooter. And like, we couldn't even prepare for that, I don't think. Not when we're not using gates and doors and stuff. It'd be impossible. Not to mention a werebeast. If a werebeast popped up, that'd be it. Oh my god. Yeah, I might be putting too many hopes and dreams on this fortress, but I'll just hope for the best, huh? It'll be interesting, to say the very least. Anyways, my bearded bastards, I hope you enjoyed watching today. I give you this whole shtick every single episode, where I thank you for watching. It feels robotic to me to just, you know, say the same thing again and again. But I just want you to know I really appreciate it, all your comments and stuff. It means an awful lot. I like doing this. I love doing this. And just to see people enjoying it means a lot. It really does. And I ain't pulling your damn leg either. This is the only thing I'm good at, which sounds low-key pitiful, but I'm just trying to get you to see how much your kind words and stuff means to me, I guess. It means a lot, even if I can't respond to every single one of you. In fact, I'm realizing that last episode I couldn't even comment back to people on the episode, and I got backed up on the episode, and I kind of had to get to work, and I don't know. Anyways, my bearded bastards, thank you so much for watching. I really, really do appreciate it, and I hope to see you next time here in Thestar Saxol, Crimsontrumpets. And until then, you bearded bastards.